So these two things conflict with each other. I think there's a happy medium in between. So we spend a lot of time in my lab trying to work on this sort of public understanding of microbes and microbiome science in the context of the complexity that I mentioned before. I actually view this now as opportunities. The complexity makes it really interesting to study. The variation within hosts makes it really interesting to study, and this sort of germophobia and microbiomania also makes it a really interesting area to be in. So what I'm going to talk about for my talk is a few examples of where I think there are opportunities in studies of microbiomes, and where we're working on this in my lab, and many other people in the community are working on similar things to try and deal with this complexity, to deal with the germophobia, to deal with the microbiomania, and to try and raise the field up to a better understanding of microbes, both from a scientific point of view and from a public point of view. So I'm going to first sort of start easy with one of the first things that people do when they use DNA to characterize a microbial community, which is called phylotyping or phylogenetic typing. And what you basically do is you go to a community, you isolate DNA from a community, you run ribosomal RNA PCR using primers that can amplify virtually any ribosomal RNA gene from that environmental sample. You sequence the ribosomal RNA genes, and again, you line them up, you compare them to ribosomal RNAs from other organisms, and you can place an unknown organism into a phylogenetic context by where it sits on the tree, and then make some predictions about that organism, or at least track that organism in different environments by where it sits in the tree. I actually first started working on this as an undergraduate at Harvard in Colleen Kavanaugh's lab, where I spent a year and a half, including after I graduated, sequencing one ribosomal RNA gene, 1,500 base pairs. I got a paper out of this. And we characterized an uncultured bacterial syngolab that lived inside some clams isolated from coastal sediments in Woods Hole, built evolutionary trees, and predicted the biology of these organisms. Now, the great thing about ribosomal RNA PCR is you can go to an environmental sample with more than one organism, get out more than one sequence, and infer what multiple organisms were in the sample. So let's say there are two organisms, you get two different ribosomal RNAs out of the sample, two different ribosomal RNAs in the alignment, and you can show that they show up in two different areas of the tree. You can count the relative abundance of these organisms by the relative number of sequences that you get out of the sample, and therefore infer something about the ecology of the sample, not just who is present in the sample. You can do this with four organisms, with 100, with 1,000, with 10,000, and now with cheap Illumina sequencing, you can do this with communities with hundreds of thousands of different taxa, and continue to use this counting to infer the relative abundance of all the different organisms in the sample. And so we use this method still in my lab to characterize the ribosome RNA just to get a lot more sequences the one I got in a year and a half of work. But we characterize communities. You can do a variety of clustering and statistical analyses to compare the entire composition of different communities and see if, for example, communities that are hypersaline have different organisms than communities that are from human microbiome, than communities that are from soil, than communities that are from other environments. And again, because sequencing has gotten cheap, we can do a lot of this. So I've actually spent a lot of time in my lab, as have many other people in the community, thinking, okay, we're drowning in sequence data. We can't look. So I actually spent a year and a half, I actually hand-aligned the ribosomal RNA sequence from Colleen Kavanaugh's lab, built a ribosomal RNA secondary structure based on the E. coli secondary structure, all this by hand. Took a year and a half. We can't, of course, do that anymore. We can't even look, really, at the data anymore. We have to build automated sequence analysis pipelines to deal with this data. So that's what we've been doing in my lab now for about 10 years, building a variety of tools to analyze ribosomal RNA sequence data in an automated manner. I'm not going to talk in a lot of detail about these tools, but basically every 6 months we realize we're 3 years behind the data and try and come up with a new tool to deal with the massive amounts of data that are coming out. We never keep up, but we're trying. What I do in my lab is apply sort of an ecological and evolutionary approach to analyzing this data, which is a little bit different than what many people do in the community. So I believe that the history of organisms is really important for understanding their biology and understanding their ecology. So we always use phylogeny as a part of interpreting these sequence data sets. Now, ribosomal RNA turns out to not be perfect. Many people have known this for a long time. I'll just give you one example of how it's not perfect. The copy number of ribosomal RNA genes varies enormously between taxa. If you want to count ribosomal RNA sequences and think you are counting the number of cells in a community, but the number of copies of ribosomal RNA varies between taxa, it doesn't actually give you a very good estimate of the relative abundance of organisms. So we've developed, in collaboration with Steve Kemble and Justin Green, a method to use the evolutionary history of organisms and the momentum of copy number of ribosomal RNAs that is conserved within particular branches to correct for the copy number variation and get better estimates of relative abundance of organisms in a system. Now, you can do all sorts of things to try and improve your ability to analyze ribosomal RNA data, but what we and many other people are starting to do as sequencing has gotten cheaper and cheaper is to just skip ribosomal RNA analysis. Go to communities, grind up the entire sample, skip the PCR, and shotgun sequence everything from the sample. And try and use analysis of that metagenomic data to get a better handle on the phylogenetic diversity and the functional diversity from that. So one thing you can do when you do shotgun sequencing from a community is you can analyze genes other than ribosomal RNA and use them to infer information about relative abundance, phylogeny, and taxonomy from the community. Many genes in bacteria do not vary in copy number to the extent that ribosomal RNA does. Many genes actually have more variation among close relatives than ribosomal RNA does. So there are many genes that are, in principle, better for analyzing communities of organisms than ribosomal RNA. The reason everyone focused on ribosomal RNA was basically because primers allowed you to focus your sequencing and amplify ribosomal RNA genes from a community, but with shotgun sequencing, we get everything. So we can now analyze the phylogenetic and ecological diversity of communities using a variety of other phylogenetic marker genes. So we spent a lot of time in my lab developing high-throughput automated methods to analyze ecology of communities based upon protein coding genes, especially single copy universal protein coding genes, and you can assign organisms to their taxonomic group, build phylogenetic trees for organisms, use the same methods you would use for ribosomal RNA, except now with a bit better resolution and a better estimate of relative abundance from a community. You can also scan through the data and find very strange things that we still can't explain. So one challenge with ribosomal RNA PCR is that the primers don't amplify everything, and not all entities have ribosomal RNA genes. So viruses don't have ribosomal RNA genes. If you want to scan through a sample and get a handle on the total diversity of the sample, it might be better to look at other genes other than ribosomal RNA. The latest from my lab is a program, oh, by the way, everything we do is released open source, published almost entirely in open access journals. We developed a program with Aaron Darling, who was a postdoc in my lab and is now in Australia, called PhyloSift, that is a Bayesian phylogenetic approach to analyzing metagenomic data. Most of the previous methods had used phylogenetic inference methods that were kind of a cheat, methods that were really fast but weren't the best optimal phylogenetic tree inference methods. This is a new, relatively fast method to use sort of what the phylogenetic community would say is a decent phylogenetic tree method for analyzing communities of organisms. And you can then take these methods and do the same thing you would do with ribosomal RNA, but now with protein coding genes, and compare the diversity of communities and the ecology of communities with a better resolution than you get with ribosomal RNA. A second aspect of analyzing the diversity of communities that is really important for understanding microbes is to take the sequence data and try and predict the functions that are present in those communities. I spent many years working on methods, this is where the phylogenomics term Randy was talking about, to do this for cultured organisms when we have the complete genome of an organism. Now we're trying to apply this to environmental communities of organisms, and I'm just going to show you a tiny bit of this. So basically what I did as a graduate student was develop a method that said if you have an unknown gene from a sample, from an organism, and you want to understand what its function is, what many people were doing at the time, and even today, are taking that sequence and doing a database search with a method like BLAST, where you identify what the most similar sequence is to your sequence of interest, and then you look up what the putative function is of that top match, and you predict the function of your uncharacterized gene from that top match. That turns out to be not the ideal method to use. It's much more useful to build an evolutionary tree of a sequence and all of its homologs, overlay onto the evolutionary tree experimentally determined functions, and predict the function of an uncharacterized gene by where it sits in an evolutionary tree relative to other genes that have been characterized. If I showed that this could work with all sorts of different protein families, we developed automated methods to do this, not very good. Other people develop better automated methods to do this. If this sounds familiar, this is phylotyping. I basically copied ribosomal RNA phylotyping and applied it to protein sequence diversity. So just like you can predict the function of an uncharacterized organism by where it sits in an evolutionary tree, you can predict the function of an uncharacterized gene by where it sits in an evolutionary tree. And you can apply this to environmental communities. We showed this with the original Venter Sargasso C study with proteorhodopsin genes, which are of incredible interest. But any type of gene that you find in an environmental sample, you should be building evolutionary trees of that gene in the homologs if you want to make predictions of the function of that gene. In collaboration with Tom Sharkin and Katie Pollard, we now have a high throughput automated method for doing this from metagenomic data called ShotMap. The paper is actually in review right now, but the software is available on GitHub if anybody's interested in it. And just as a quick aside, there's something that we've done a lot in genomes that we're still struggling to figure out how to do in metagenomic genomes that I thought I would mention. So if you take an organism and sequence its genome, you've grown it in the lab, and you want to predict the functions present in the genome, there are lots of tools. Of course, I would argue that the phylogenetic tools are great. But imagine this scenario. You have a gene in the genome. It has homologs in a database. And none of those homologs have been experimentally characterized. Doesn't matter what method you use to select the genes, the top hit, or the evolutionary tree, or rolling dice, or whatever, you're not going to be able to predict the functions of the genes using that type of approach. And so we ran into a scenario sort of like this with the study of this weird thermophile called Proboxidothermus hydrogeniformans, produces hydrogen gas as a byproduct of its metabolism and lives on carbon monoxide. And when we sequenced the genome, if you scan through the annotation of the genome, we found homologs of sporulation genes in the genome. It's related to sporulating low GC gram-positive species, so this seemed plausible, although we had tried to get it to sporulate. Our collaborator Frank Robb eventually did get it to form these endospores. That's not what I'm here to tell you about. What I'm here to tell you about is this strange thing that we found, which turns out to be really useful, which is we took the genes in the genome, and we found homologs of these sporulation genes, but we also found, of course, hundreds of genes that had no predictable function. We called them conserved hypothetical genes at the time. So we took the genome and ran this analysis called phylogenetic profiling, originally developed by Pellegrini and colleagues at UCLA, where you take genes and you group them by their distribution pattern across species. So you look for genes that have shared presence and absence across species. They may have no sequence similarity whatsoever to each other. And we found a list of genes in Proboxidothermus hydrogeniformans that had shared presence and absence across species and were present in sporulating species and not non-sporulating species. And what's really interesting is on this list, many of the genes we could annotate because they had homologs in characterized organisms like Bacillus subtilis, but half of the genes in this cluster had conserved hypothetical annotation, no known function. And what we did is we went to Rich Lozick, who was the world expert on characterizing sporulation genes in Bacillus subtilis at the time, sent him our list, and he basically went through our list and then made knockouts in Bacillus subtilis and showed that every single gene on this list that was annotated as a conserved hypothetical protein was involved in sporulation. This is an incredible tool for discovering the function of genes that don't have any sequence similarity to genes of known function. And we use this all the time in characterizing cultured organisms, but we have no good method still to use this for metagenomic communities. There are people who have tried this. We think that you can cluster gene presence and absence by community or by environmental variable like pH or salinity and come up with these types of predictions, but as far as I know, there are no sort of good methods to do this from environmental. So we go through this community data, we try and identify the organisms by this phylotyping or variety of phylogenetic approaches, we try try and compare the diversity of communities. We then try and predict the functions present in the community, maybe with phylogenetic methods or some other approach. What we really want to do is link the phylogeny to the function. We want to know which functions are present in which organisms. When we go to a community and we grind it up and then try and infer what's going on in the community, community is not a bag of genes. It is a compartments of organisms that interact with each other genetically and by communication systems, and they're contained within these, you know, cells, compartments and things. So what we really want to do is go to these communities and better link the functions that we infer in the community with the taxa and the phylogeny of the organisms from those communities. And this has been a big struggle in metagenomic studies. I'm just going to give you a couple of examples of how sort of the latest methods that we're trying to go about doing this. One of them was developed by a graduate student in my lab, Chris Patel, who had been working in a plant genomics lab where they were using this method that people have used to look at chromatin structure within eukaryotic cells, where you can cross-link DNA within a cell and thereby detect different regions of the genome that are physically close within the cell.